Hello, hi. Okay, little red light's on, so that means it must be live. Great. Hello, my name's Luke Eastwood, which you can probably see my name in the corner. I'm talking to you from the Moon Books, who are bringing out my next book, which I'm going to be talking to you about mostly. I'll probably talk about some of my other books too. But first of all, I suppose I should introduce myself for people who don't know who I am or haven't come across any of my work before. I guess I'm a druid. I'm also a graphic designer, a musician, and a horticulturist. And well, with relation to the new book, that's very much connected with horticulture. It's called The Druid Garden, which I'm going to show you what that looks like now. You can see that all right. Anyway, how that came about is a bit unusual, I suppose. I used to work as a graphic designer when I lived in London, and because I lived in London for 10 years. Then I moved to County Wexford in Ireland, and it's not too bad a drive to Dublin. I used to work in Dublin for a graphic design company. And then I started my own business, and then come 2007, things started going a bit bad. I mean, business was still good as such, but it was taking ages to get paid because the recession was already sort of on its way in the post, if you will. So I decided, I want to get out of this. I found that it didn't really sit very well anyway with my personal beliefs. I'd describe myself as I suppose a corporate whore at the time. I was putting my creativity out to tender, really. A lot of it's sort of unethical, really. You're taking products that people probably don't really need or want and trying to convince them that it's great. Well, that's what advertising is about, marketing is about to a large extent. It depends what you're selling, but in a lot of cases it's a big pile of rubbish. And your job is to sell that. So I wasn't overly happy with it. So I thought, well, hey, what could I do that actually is more connected with what I believe in, what my spiritual beliefs are? So gardening seemed to be the obvious answer to me. I got back into gardening back in London when I lived in this big Georgian house I shared with, well, it was split up into flats anyway, but the back garden was kind of abandoned. I found that really good stress relief. I'd come home from work and just go and fiddle around in the garden. At the time, I didn't know an awful lot, although, my parents had got me to help them in the garden very reluctantly when I was a kid. Instead of, kicking the ball about, I might have been shelling peas. And I remember my dad gave me a little patch of garden to look after, a bit square, and it all died. I forgot to water it. I forgot to weed it. It was terrible, terrible, negligent gardener. But then I was only like 7 or 8 years old, so that's kind of understandable, I think. Anyway, later on, I got this renewed interest. Like I said, as I was in London, found it very stress relieving. And then later, I thought, well, okay, I've got to get out of this business because one of the things that happens when you get a recession is things like advertising, marketing are going to get absolutely crucified. And I knew that was bound to happen. So I retrained as a horticulturist up in Dublin at the Dublin School of Horticulture. And I couldn't sell my business, but I closed it down when the recession hit and I got a job in a garden centre. And that was really, that was my career change. And I really felt that was a lot more me You know, so that really was the beginning of tying in my Druid knowledge, a spiritual knowledge, with the practical side of gardening. I suppose I'm lucky in that sense, in that I can actually bring these two things together because I've got experience in both of them. So anyway, that wasn't my first book for Moon Books. The first one I did, I'm going to show you, which is this book here called the Druid's Primer. And that has an introduction written by Philip Cargom of the Order of Bards, Hobbits and Druids, which is very kind of him to do. So this is more about general Druidry, the history of the Druids, cosmology, what people do, the different gods and goddesses, the seasons, all that kind of stuff. So it's sort of what people call a 101 book, sort of everything you might want to know about Druids and Druidry kind of thing. So, and that took me quite a long time. I suppose I wrote it very much for myself as much as anyone else, because I've got a pretty bad memory, and I do have a massive library of books I've been lucky enough to collect over, I suppose, the last 25 years, really. I've been buying kind of books on Druidry, some going very old and some a bit more modern. And I just thought, well, this would be a good way of distilling it down into a small volume that I can actually use myself. And I do from occasion actually dip into it and look things up that I've forgotten. So, you know, that was actually very useful for me to write this book, because it kind of reminded me of stuff that I forget. And I've got a smaller reference guide rather than having a big shelf that I have to go and dip into. Of course, that's still there and I do use it, but I found, you know, I actually write a lot for my own self, really, rather than for other people. I suppose it's a bit self-indulgent and selfish, but I figured, well, if I don't like my own work or I don't find it interesting myself, then what's the point in bothering to do it? So I've written for what pleases me, and I just hope that other people will find that interesting and worthwhile as well. So the second book I did for Moon Books is this very small book called The Journey, which is, I'm not very good at getting this in front of camera, there we go. This is probably my favorite book, actually. It's very small. It's sort of a book of mixed bag spirituality, I suppose. It's very eclectic. It refers to all kinds of religious people of the past, like the Buddha, Zoroaster. There's a little bit, I think there's a bit of Jesus, Muhammad, all kinds of stuff, Native American wisdom, Druid stuff. And my own reflections on spirituality and what life is meant to be about. It's pretty small. You could read it in, I don't know, probably read it in half an hour. But as I said, that's my favorite book I've written. So anyway, and like the new book I'll come to in a minute, but the last one I did before that is this book, which is called How to Save the Planet, which sounds a bit arrogant in a way, as if like, oh, I've got all the answers. No, I haven't got all the answers, but I think collectively humanity does have all the answers. And whether you're religious or not, I think most of these answers are straightforward. Really, whether you're coming from a secular perspective, whether you're a Christian, Buddhist, Druid or whatever, it's very much about consciousness, awareness, and being mindful about how you live. And that's universal, really. I don't think that applies to any one particular religion. This book I actually published myself because one of the things I wanted was it to be printed on recycled paper, which it is. Most publishers are still using FSC, which is sort of, well, I consider it pretty bogus, to be honest. What happens is they call them managed forests. Well, that means like they chop down a lovely big old forest and they replant it with spruce trees and then, you know, harvest them and then sow more again. And they do so, I think, 3 for every tree they chop down. But the trouble is, it's still not really that environmentally friendly because these plantations are, they're kind of bereft of life, really. Sorry. There's nothing in them. There's just these big old spruce trees, very little gaps for light, and that's not really what I'm about. One of the things I'm really interested in is the environmental movement. That's something I've been interested in since I was, since I was a teenager. When I was at college, I was about 17. I was joined a conservation group where we actually went round the college, which was on this big estate. It had formerly been owned by some lord or something, and cleaning it up, cutting back all these out of control rhododendrons to encourage other plants to grow. And I got involved in Greenpeace, with some of the protests in London. And more recently, I got involved in Extinction Rebellion. So I wrote that book pretty much with a mind of trying to show people lots of simple things that you can do to make a difference. And I mean, you could look at it and say, oh, well, what can I do? I'm just one person and the government needs to sort this out. But really, if everybody does something, it will make a difference. And I in that book, there's 10 points of different things that you could do to make a real and concrete difference to the future of the planet. So that's quite a short book, but it goes into all those things in detail and some kind of explanation of why the world is in a big old mess. My plan is to give half the profits of that to Greenpeace and Friends of the Earth. So hopefully that will make some difference to people's perceptions. And that kind of, in a way, led to the next book, which I think I showed you at the beginning. I suppose there you go again, the Druid Garden, which is primarily what I wanted to talk about. Because all this stuff sort of comes together, the spirituality, the environmentalism, and gardening, all comes together in this book. Because, I've noticed, certainly myself, when I've been to the houses of people who are involved in, you know, the esoteric movement, Druidry or shamanism, and, you know, I probably didn't say anything, but I've at times been quite shocked that these people that are, you know, they love the earth and they're very connected to the earth seemingly, but, you know, they have these barren gardens with nothing in there, just sort of a horrible grassy patch and, you know, a few weeds and no plants. And I was like, that's a bit odd. Okay, people are busy, but I couldn't get my head around that. How you could fail to implement your beliefs in your actual everyday life. Okay, people sometimes might have an army of kids, or they might be a single parent, etc. So it's understandable to some extent, but there's a lot you can do in a very short space of time without making monumental efforts. And one of the things I used to do a few years back was I used to teach a class, an 8-week class on how to grow fruit and vegetables in the organic way. And it struck me that there's people that have a real interest in this, but they don't have a clue what to do. So, when you don't know anything, it can be quite difficult. I mean, I think back, an example I gave some people on the talk was me learning to ride a bike. I remember when the training wheels came off, I used to keep crashing it, and I couldn't, I'm left-handed, I couldn't turn right at all. I could only turn left. So I remember my parents trying to teach me how to do this, and I just kept crashing repeatedly over and over, ended up upside down in the hedge in the end, at which point I think they gave up. So, I would have been maybe 5 or 6 at this point of time, I think. But now, obviously, that seems ridiculous now. But it's the same in anything. It's the same in gardening. When you first try to do a bit of gardening and you don't know anything about plants or about the soil or how it works, it is difficult. But I made up this course very simply to start off from absolute basics, and take you through to at the end of the 8 weeks that you'd be able to competently grow plants, trees properly, do cuttings, sow seedlings, bring all your fruit and vegetables to grow well, hopefully, and end up with a decent crop of food. Because there's nothing more depressing than putting a load of effort into something like that. Say you plant a load of tomato plants and they all die and you don't get any tomatoes. That's pretty depressing. So, I designed the course so that it was pretty basic and you build up from ground level so that people would by the end of it be have the necessary skills to actually make it work. Obviously you can't do anything about hurricanes or like weeks and weeks of rain, but under average conditions most people should be able to have fairly successful results with doing gardening. So that's where that came from. And also I thought very much about the idea of really living your spiritual beliefs. Like for me, my understanding of the world and where I come into it is very much defined by my Druid beliefs. I would be very much what you call an animist. I would believe that God or deity or whatever you want to call it is alive in everything, exists. That God or the goddess or supernatural, whatever, the creator permeates every living thing, not just on this planet, but if there's other planets with life, it would be the same there. So you in a way you could say, I believe that all life is sacred, that it is not just a bunch of dirt or some an earwig is just a useless, pointless thing. Everything has its purpose, everything has its value. And that's a belief that you'll find in Druidism. So when I think about plants, I think about working with the land. It's not just stuff to me, like the soil isn't just a load of dirt. And plants aren't just objects that are there for me to pull up and eat. And the same with animals. They have a right to exist in their own right. They are part of the creation and they are important. In fact, from a certain point of view, I would say they're no less important than humans are. A slug, we may want to get rid of it because it's going to eat our cabbages, but it does have a right to live. And in a certain way, you could say it's no less valuable to the creation than a human being is, even though it's not sentient or it can't do anything in a conscious way like we can. it's still an important part of the world, the ecosystem, because all these parts do fit together. I watched David Attenborough's documentary recently, his film, and you know, he would actually make a brilliant druid, because his philosophy on life, his understanding of how nature fits together, how everything is interconnected, how it's a living system, an ecosystem that's so interconnected that when you remove certain parts, it's possible the whole thing to collapse. That very much fits with the Druid view of what the world is like and how the world functions. So I would very much be in agreement that if you start ripping up parts of the world, then you're in the same way as if you know the game Jenga, you pull out the pieces of wood, eventually the whole stack of pieces just collapses and then the game's over. Obviously, this is not a game. Human life and the world of that we live in, the earth and all life upon it, that isn't a game. So if we end up pulling out all the pieces and the earth collapses, that's not going to be funny, because there's no winner, there's only losers, and everybody loses. So I've written this from a point of view of trying to guide people into doing things in a better way, certainly as far as working with the garden is concerned. And it starts off with a lot of history, because I think if you understand history, it helps you to understand today and why we're at this point in time now, why we are on the edge of a crisis. Whether you think it's because of climate change, or whether it's just down to general pollution or down to overpopulation, it doesn't really matter what the cause is as such, because we're in this crisis. You know, it's like if a house is on fire, you know, you're not going to be worrying too much about who started the fire at that point. You'd be more worried about putting the fire out. And then you can deal with who's to blame for it afterwards when the fire has been put out. I think pretty much you could say, in a way, using that same metaphor, there's a lot of finger pointing going on and people blaming each other and shouting, oh, look, the house is on fire, it's all your fault, or we need to do this, we need to do that. But instead of actually pointing out that the house is on fire, perhaps we actually need to start doing something to put the fire out. Go and get some buckets of water and start throwing them on the house instead of talking about what we're going to do. And that's one of the reasons why I got involved in Extinction Rebellion, because that's very much about actually getting something done, actually getting people to stop talking and start doing something. So anyway, at the beginning of the book, as I said, it goes through the history. It goes from really the end of the hunter-gatherer period. And I mentioned Göbekli Tepe, which is in Turkey, which has relatively recently been discovered. And it would seem that people have been civilized for a lot longer than we thought. That's about 12,000 years old, I think. Yeah, about 10,000 BC that was constructed. They've only excavated about 20% of the site so far, so there might be parts of it that are even older. So you can see there's a sacred temple. This has images of mostly animals in there. It's quite complex. And some people think they were still hunter-gatherers. Personally, I think the people that built it were already using agriculture. Now, that was obviously a tribal society at that time. And over time, we've moved through various stages of civilization, city-states like Ur in Mesopotamia, and onto empires and much more and more complicated ways of living. So I've traced that. And through that, the history of agriculture and gardening as it's unfolded. And what I found really interesting was to discover that actually the Europeans were really backward the further I go back in time, rather than being an advanced culture, we had a relatively backwards culture, certainly in terms of agriculture. So if you go back 6,000 years, a lot of people in Europe were just using very basic hand tools and maybe not even using animals to help them. Whereas you'll find in places like Mesopotamia, they'd already got irrigation, they'd already started using animals, they had properly designed tools. And well, going forward, you'll find like in China, they invented the wheelbarrow. That wasn't a European invention. Lots of innovations came from Persia and also from Egypt as well. And eventually, as we come forward in time, these migrated into Europe. And eventually, you got a sort of a renaissance of Greco-Roman culture. But it wasn't just that. A lot of the ideas about gardening that you'll see in modern life actually come from the Renaissance and from the Persians, primarily. The Persian garden inspired the Italians, along with the Roman ideas. And with the collapse of Byzantium, a lot of the ideas that were held by the Persians and by the Byzantines were re-imported into Europe. So you got this sudden flourishing of agriculture and gardening, and all this information which had been basically lost for, well, probably up to, yeah, 1,000 years in some cases, had been largely forgotten about. So I've covered some of that, but also because it's called the Druid Garden, it focuses a lot on the Druids, the knowledge that was passed down. And we know that the Druids were certainly around in Europe before the Common Era, before Jesus, and a lot of this information has not been recorded by the Romans. It's been passed down orally. You do have some bits of information, certainly in Wales, and primarily in Ireland, you've got details about herbs and folklore that's been retained. Some of it may have been written down at quite a late stage, but that information of the Druids' understanding of the cosmos, of their use of herbs in medicine primarily, has been retained, and you'll find a lot of that in the book, and also the magical and folklore and traditions around plants. I've covered that a great deal. So a lot of people watching this may be familiar with Ogham, or some people call it Ogham. I think Ogham is the right pronunciation. But this is the old Irish alphabet going back into the pre-Christian times. Some people date it as 4th-5th century, but personally I think it's a bit older than that. But associated with that is the trees. Some people would describe it as a tree alphabet, which I'd agree with. Other people would say, no, it's not specifically a tree alphabet. But I've covered all of the trees that are associated with Ogham. But what I've also done is look at the whole of Western Europe, Britain and France, and all the way over across to the Danube region, because that is the area that the Druids would have lived in at some time. I know they disappeared out of parts of Eastern Europe and then eventually out of Gaul as well. They were, I suppose, eviscerated by the Romans. But they would have been aware of the plants, not just that live in Ireland, but that live in Britain and live in Western and Central Europe. So I've tried to cover those in the book, plants, bushes, and trees as well. So as well as that, I've covered a lot of information about soil. As I was saying, soil isn't just dirt, it actually contains an awful lot of life. And that life, that the microorganisms that live in soil are actually vital to the health of everything, of plants and of animals that live in and on the surface of the soil. If you sterilize everything, it does make a huge difference to how things grow. The same if you use lots of nasty pesticides and you don't retain the natural balance of nutrients. It sends everything out of balance and you end up having very seriously bad results. And you can see across the world with this green revolution, which seemed like a brilliant idea to feed the world, you know, bring in tractors everywhere, start sowing huge fields full of crops. That's actually has turned out not to be the success they believed it would be. It started really in the 1950s onwards. You've now got countries with terrible problems because of monoculture crops, total lack of biodiversity. I mean, gosh, look at Borneo. That used to be covered in rainforest. Now it's covered in palm plantations. It's a complete disaster, not just for the orangutans, but for the people that live there, for the general environment. So this kind of attitude of seeing the world as just an object to be exploited ultimately ends up in a disaster. And I think we're beginning to see that now. Previous generations may have been thinking, oh, well, look, this is great. You know, look at all the money we're making, or we've got tons of crops. But in the long term, it doesn't work. This kind of strategy ends up with you having to use more and more chemicals, with the biodiversity being completely destroyed. And, you know, as many scientists have pointed out, if we end up destroying the insect pollinators, the bees especially, that's pretty much the end. Human life, in fact, most of the life on this planet will die if we lose the pollinators. So, I mean, the people are really, you know, short-sighted thinking that now is beginning to change. People are beginning to cop on to the fact that we are wrecking the planet. I think personally, a lot of this is down to pollution and over farming and putting too many people in one particular area. So, you know, land just gets stressed and then eventually collapses and is unsustainable. Obviously, changes in climate are a big factor too, but I think blaming it all on climate is a bit of a false premise. You know, if you look at the seas full of plastic, that's not really to do with the climate, that's to do with us being thoughtless and polluting the hell out of the place and just overproducing and not disposing of all this plastic. There are alternatives. There's lots of viable alternatives, some of which are mentioned in my previous book. But I mean, one of the biggest things I think we could do is actually start using our spaces, using open spaces in villages and towns that are just sitting there doing nothing. They can be turned into beautiful gardens. You know, and if you say you might have a very small garden, you could have, like, say, a 20-foot garden. That doesn't mean you can't do anything with it. You could still plant trees, you could grow fruit and vegetables, you could grow wildflowers, lots of different flowers that the insects and birds would love. And I think that there's tremendous scope for what could be done to change things. A massive amount of quite simple solutions to change things. So I would encourage people, even if you're not interested particularly in druids or anything like that, or even if you don't really like gardening, that you think about the possibility of using the spaces you've got, at least for the sake of the environment, even if you're not that interested in growing trees or plants. If everybody who has a garden or has a space like a wasteland near where they live went out and planted even just one tree, that would make an absolutely huge difference to the environment. As trees are vitally important. One of the things that's a big problem in places like Bangladesh is erosion, because lots of trees are being chopped down, and when all the floodwaters from the Himalayas come cascading down, this huge amount of water is not absorbed by trees. The soil is just washed away into the sea because the trees that used to hold it there are no longer there. So that's causing devastation, not just to humans, but to the whole environment. And, you know, if that doesn't stop, eventually parts of that country will become uninhabitable, because there won't be any soil left on which to grow anything. And you could already see that in, you know, if you look at, I mentioned the city of Ur in former Mesopotamia, now it's in Iraq. That site is just completely surrounded by desert. That would have been lush and green and beautiful once upon a time. So you can see the great ziggurat there, which has been, you know, pulled out of the sand. But there's nothing growing. There's virtually nothing there. And that's down to human error, human stupidity, negligence, whatever you want to call it. And we've now got this great understanding. We've got technology. We've got the know-how to fix all of these problems. It just really needs the will. I mean, even people say, if you live in an apartment, if you even then you can still grow stuff. You can put things in containers and window boxes, you know, in large pots if you've got windows. Personally, I find it really fulfilling to grow stuff. I get a kick out of doing it, actually, but purely from an altruistic point of view, doing something good. Every time you plant something, it's helping the environment. And for me, there's a spiritual connection. I very much am fond of trees, and I feel a strong connection to them. And I feel connected to the symbolism of the world tree, which you'll find in Druidism. You'll also find that common to Norse religion, to Judaism, and the Buddhists as well. So it's quite a powerful symbol for the connection between different parts of the world. The world tree, I suppose, is sort of a cosmic tree, connects the physical world with the underworld and the upper world. So you can look at this on many different levels. It might have a deep religious significance to you. It may just be something that you're interested in. You might be an environmentalist, or you might have a genuine interest in gardening and improving your gardening. But I think whatever the reason is, it's something that's worth doing, because we are clearly in a time where we are running out of time, where if we don't make changes about how we live, there will be another generation. There may not be a generation after that. We might end up just making the world uninhabitable for ourselves. So for me, writing this book is very much part of trying to be the change, to influence people in a way which will actually constructively and practically make some difference to to the future for future generations. So I think we really don't have any choice. We've got to do something, whether it's gardening or whether you choose a different area of life where you want to make an impact. We really are going to have to think about the environment and how we deal with it, where we fit into it, and actually stop seeing ourselves separate from the world, as separate from everything else around us, because in truth we are not separate. We are part of a giant ecosystem, and we've got away with this kind of reckless attitude for a long time, but those days are over. We don't have any choice anymore. So I hope you find that book interesting, or maybe some of my others. If you want to see more about the books, you can go to the Moon Books website, or you can go to my own website, which is lukeeastwood.com. And I hope you found that informative, and thank you very much for listening.